A well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state. The right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. This is the Second Amendment, and this is the Gun Guy.
Boom, 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 boom. Bang, 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 bang. Boom, 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 boom. Bang, bang, bang.
With Guy Ralford on 93 WIBC.
And good evening. This is Guy Ralford. This is the Gun Guy Show on 93 WIBC. Tonight we're going to talk about a number of things.
As we get into the show, we're going to talk about a number of things. Including an update on the ordinance to keep Eagle Creek Pistol Range open to the public. We've talked about that a few times here on the Gun Guy Show, and I know there's a lot of interest in that. At the bottom of this hour, we're going to have City Councilor Aaron Freeman in to join us, and he's one of the city councilors who introduced an ordinance that would require Eagle Creek to be open to the public when it's not being used for training purposes by IMPD. And there was a hearing on that, a committee hearing, this week. And so there's some developments, not a lot. It was sort of put on hold for now. But Councilor Freeman can give us a bit of an update on that. But we want to start off talking about, in addition to taking your calls about whatever you, the WIBC listening audience, wants to talk about, there's been a lot, I think, of confusion in media discussion over a lawsuit that's going on over the Sandy Hook shooting. And if you've heard about this, obviously Sandy Hook was a horrific tragedy when Adam Lanza went into Sandy Hook Elementary with an AR-15 and killed a number of innocent people, including 20 school children. But there's now a lawsuit pending. The lawsuit's called Soto versus Bushmaster. And this is where a number of the surviving relatives or the heirs, parents of the victims of Sandy Hook are suing Bushmaster, who made the rifle, specifically the AR-15 that Adam Lanza used in the Sandy Hook shooting. And there has been, I think, a lot of outrage over this lawsuit in the sense that we're blaming the manufacturer of the instrumentality when the manufacturer didn't do anything illegal. All the manufacturer did was lawfully sell a firearm. So how can they be held liable? I mean, if a person takes a car and intentionally runs over a group of people standing at the bus stop, it would be unusual for Ford or GM to get sued as the manufacturer of the car because someone took their product that they sold legally and committed a criminal act with it. And here, yes, Adam Lanza committed a absolutely horrible, horrific crime where a number of innocent people, including school children, lost their lives. But does that make the manufacturer of the rifle that he used responsible, legally responsible, for those deaths and for the injuries that occurred among the wounded? Well, as you've probably seen, if you're following this issue at all on social media or on in the news, there was a ruling last week where the judge in that lawsuit refused to throw it out and issued a decision denying a motion to dismiss, and then later on set a trial date. And what I saw reported a lot was, oh my gosh, the case is going to trial. We're going to get to the jury on this case. And that's not exactly where we are in the lawsuit. So I want to talk a little bit about the lawsuit. And as always, we want to take your calls. We got a number of people calling in already, and we want to talk about whatever gun-related issue, whether it's a legal issue, a training issue, a technical issue relating to firearms, you name it. You have a question, you call in and we'll talk about it. But I also want to make sure people are clear about this Sandy Hook lawsuit, because again, I think understandably there's a lot of outrage that the judge refused to throw the lawsuit out and then set a trial date going, you know, and the natural reaction to that is for a lot of people to go, this is a case that should never reach a jury. This should not go to trial. It shouldn't see the light of day. But here's what's going on more specifically about that lawsuit. The the motion to dismiss that was filed by the defendants was on jurisdictional grounds. In other words, the defendant said this court, and it's a state court in Connecticut, simply didn't have jurisdiction to even hear the case because of a federal statute that provides immunity to gun manufacturers. It's called the Protection of Lawful Commerce in Arms Act, and it's a federal statute. And we, by the way, have a state statute here in Indiana that seeks to accomplish the same thing. And this was a statute enacted to protect a firearms manufacturer or seller who sells a gun lawfully and does nothing else to contribute to some injury or damage caused by that gun downstream by someone acting unlawfully with it. And that seems to make a lot of sense. If you do nothing illegal as part of selling a gun and someone takes your product, or if you do nothing illegal and in making a gun and someone takes your product and commits a criminal act with it, like Adam Lanza did, then how can you be held legally responsible for that? How can you get sued? Well, we have a federal statute and a state statute. In the case in Connecticut, the Sandy Hook case, the defendants argued there was simply no jurisdiction for the court to even hear the case because of the federal statute that protects gun manufacturers. And in denying that motion to dismiss, what the judge said was, no, I have jurisdiction. I can hear the case. It's not a matter of that the case can't be resolved in my court. It can be. And we're going to go down the road of litigating the lawsuit in my court, and we're going to consider, for instance, whether the Protection of Lawful Commerce in Arms Act provides a defense to the defendants or not, and that likely will be resolved before trial. In other words, all the issues regarding liability under the act and whether this act provides protection in this instance where Remington lawfully sold an AR-15 and that then was used unlawfully in a criminal act, whether that in fact provides a defense that should then result in the dismissal of the lawsuit. So that issue's alive and well. That's the point I want to make. Don't think that the judge has rejected the defense under the statute, in part because there are a couple of exceptions under the statute, like if you allege something called a negligent entrustment. So if a manufacturer or a seller entrusts a particular firearm to a particular individual and they should know that that person will then hurt someone with it, and they nonetheless entrust that weapon to them, they can be sued for that. Well, they said, well, that's an exception, and so we now need to litigate, for instance, whether that exception applies. Now, Remington didn't entrust its gun to anybody in this situation, I'm sure, other than a distributor. And probably never knew who that distributor sold the gun to in terms of the retailer, and sure as hell didn't know that that retailer then sold the gun to Adam Lanza's mom, who would then have the gun stolen from her after being murdered so that that gun could then be used in a crime. So how you're going to make a negligent entrustment case against Remington, I certainly don't know. And this is exactly the area I practice in. And I don't have a first clue how you make that case. But that's not really the issue. The issue is the court simply said those issues can be resolved and will be resolved in her courtroom, and that she has jurisdiction to hear the case. So it doesn't make the lawsuit any more ridiculous. And I'm not arguing against anyone who says this is crazy, this lawsuit should never have been filed, and it now ought to be thrown out. I agree with you completely, but I don't want anybody to overreact because, by the way, judges set scheduling orders, we call them, that set out all kinds of different deadlines, including deadlines for additional what we call dispositive motions, motions that can dispose of the case. And I'm sure as part of her scheduling order, she lays out all those actions, including when the process for exchanging information between the parties, what we call discovery, and when motion practice ends. And at the end of that time frame is a trial date. as it always is, in any judge's scheduling order. So don't think, when you read the media reports about this silly lawsuit, that it's necessarily going to trial. It just means the court has decided that she had jurisdiction. This judge has jurisdiction to hear the case. And all those other issues are alive and well. So we're going to take a break. We're going into a break here at the quarter hour. We got a whole bunch of people on hold already, so we're going to get to your calls as soon as we come back from the break. So stick around. Join the discussion. The number is 239-9393, or just pound 9393 from your cell phone. But join the discussion. This is Guy Relford on The Gun Guy Show on 93 WIBC.
Now you've got a gun guy, Guy Relford, on 93 WIBC.
All right, welcome back to the Gun Guy Show. This is Guy Relford on 93 WIBC, and tonight we're talking about this lawsuit over the Sandy Hook shooting, Cosoto versus Bushmaster, where families of the victims and some of those wounded are suing the manufacturer of the rifle that Adam Lanza used to murder all those innocent people and wound several more. And tell you what, we're going to go right to the phone lines because we've got a number of people on hold and we want to get to all of you. So we're going to go straight to David. David, welcome to the Gun Guy Show.
Hey, Guy. How you doing, man? Happy good. AR-15 Saturday.
yeah, exactly. What you got for us, Dave?
Well, you know, stuff like this, I figured out why it frustrates me when I hear about stupid this is a family show. This is the best I can do. This stupid stuff like this. I feel like I'm being treated, as a legal, lawful gun owner, I feel like I'm being treated like I'm 5 years old. So, God forbid they start holding manufacturers accountable for the unlawful misuse of their product, because we're not going to have, besides guns, we're not going to have cars, baseball bats, hammers, bad food, and,
pharmaceuticals, it just goes on and on.
Pharmaceuticals, any movie starring Will Ferrell. I mean, we're really going to be up the creek. So if we get to Wacko Bird Land, I had an idea. How about we sue Obama personally? We sue Pelosi and Chuck Schumer for creating gun-free zones. Their presence obviously caused death. So, therefore, I think they should be liable just as well.
Yeah, well, Dave, thanks for your call, buddy. And I got a couple of comments. One is, as far as being, you know, treated like a five-year-old, you would feel more that way, David, if you actually read the complaint in this case. The complaint is where the plaintiffs lay out the substance of their lawsuit. And what they're saying is, as to an AR-15, that is a gun designed solely for the military, that civilians are incapable of using it safely or lawfully, and that because Bushmaster sold its rifle into the civilian market, essentially knowing that civilians are incapable of using that gun safely, since they're not members of the military, that Bushmaster should be held liable. Essentially, that we as civilians are incompetent to use an AR-15. That's one of the theories of the lawsuit. So if you'd read that, you'd feel even more about the manner in which we're being treated by plaintiff's attorneys in a situation like this. And I'll say, we'll leave it at that. We'll go right back to the phone lines. We've got Kevin. Kevin, welcome to the Gun Guy Show.
Yeah, hi. I'm a regular listener. I don't miss a minute of your show. I really, really love it.
Oh, man, I appreciate that.
I'm probably the most against person on the open carry of anyone, and I will give you a prime example, then I'll get off and people can call and they can insult me and whatever. This is Kevin from Carmel. Okay. I shoot at range over here. What is it?
Point blank.
Yeah, I shoot over there Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. I'm the first guy in the door every morning. Anyway, a good friend of mine, 74 years old, disabled 74-year-old guy, went downtown last weekend with his wife to have dinner. He can't walk from the garage to the car, so she dropped him off on the corner, and they went in and had dinner, and then he came out and he waited there, and then she went to the parking garage to get the car. Some 20-25 year old kid on a crotch rocket comes by and looks at him and says, "Hey, old man, you got a problem or something?" And he said, "No, man, I'm just standing here." He said, well, you don't dare, you know, something to the effect of, you don't dare look at me, or who in the hell do you think you're looking at? You know, trying to initiate a fight with a 74-year-old disabled guy.
Okay, Kevin, I'm missing the point, though, about how this relates to open carry.
Okay, well, the guy had open carry. The guy had a pistol on his side.
Your friend, the 74-year-old?
No. The guy on the motorcycle had a pistol on his side, and my friend didn't know. He's not a shooter. He didn't know that was legal. He said that was why I was looking at him. I thought, why is this guy carrying a pistol on his side driving around downtown Indianapolis Saturday night?
I got you, buddy. And Kevin, thanks for your call. One thing that is just fundamentally true, and I don't think that the most adamant open carrier on the planet would argue with us, is that if you open carry, you're going to attract some attention. And a lot of times that can be unwanted attention. Sometimes it can be attention from law enforcement officers. And that's just the nature of the beast. Now, what I won't go so far as to say, though, is that I dispute anybody's right to open carry in Indiana with a license to carry handgun, because you've got that license that allows you under the law to open carry if you want to. And I think that most reactions, negative reactions or fearful reactions about someone open carrying are simply because people aren't well educated and simply don't understand much about guns or much about carrying a gun. And if I see a person open carrying in an adequate holster with the trigger protected, the only conclusion I'm going to draw is that that person's not a felon. They're not an alcohol abuser. They're not a drug abuser. And they've never been convicted of a crime of domestic violence and any number of other of good things about that person, because I'm assuming nobody's stupid enough to open carry if they don't have a license carry handgun. But Kevin's point is still a good one, because if you open carry, you know, even though that's absolutely your right, and I absolutely support that right, and I support that decision if you make it, you better expect to get some additional attention. And if I'm open carrying and I look up and somebody's looking at me because I'm on my motorcycle, I ride a motorcycle. I don't open carry when I'm on my motorcycle, but occasionally my jacket will fly up because I'm in the wind or whatever. And I'm sure someone has seen me with a gun on my motorcycle. If I saw somebody staring at me while I'm open carrying, hypothetically, on a motorcycle or when my jacket's flapping around and somebody could potentially see my gun, I'm not going to be insulted by virtue of the fact that someone's looking at me because I'm carrying a gun. So that's just kind of nature of the beast and something you need to accept if you make that decision to open carry. All right, we'll go right back to the phone lines, and we've got Charles. Charles, welcome to the Gun Guy Show.
Well, this kind of off, you know, every so often I pull one of these out of the hat for you. I wasn't certain how old you were. The reason I'm asking, they had a survey. I caught one of them on one of the channels, and they were trying to figure out, of all things, what was the most popular offbeat gun that a character would carry back in the old late 50s, early 60s Westerns.
I'm 58, so that's stretching me a little bit.
Well, I did know. I'm coming up on 69 years old, so they were almost as old as the Wild West was. But they rated Chuck Connors number one with Rifleman rifle, as we called it. Number two was our Beech Grove, Indiana boy. There is Steve McQueen with that sawed-off, I'm not even sure, but they called it the mare's leg, because I think when it hit the guys, it looked more like a shotgun than a Winchester. And then Hugh O'Brien is wired up with the old Buttline Special. But I was just curious if you ever had, you know, even with all these shows now, these old MeTV and Cozy and all those showing a lot of the old reruns, but if any, I, again, didn't know how old you were. I was just curious if you had a favorite gun as a kid. A fake, that is.
Oh, you know what? I mean, not as a little kid. I'll tell you what, Chuck Connors and the Rifleman with that Winchester lever action, I believe it was a Winchester lever action rifle that he had, was just an awesome gun. I love the way he could cock it one handed with that lever action. It was pretty darn cool. And of course, any of the old Western style guns were just awesome as well. But that was long before I could look at a gun and identify it and even know what it was. Probably the first gun that I really got enamored with, just from seeing it in movies or TV, was the I believe it was the Smith & Wesson Model 29 44 Magnum that Dirty Harry carried. I mean, that got everybody's attention, especially that line, you know, this is the most powerful handgun in the world and it'll blow your head clean off and all that silly stuff that was in that movie. But it was pretty awesome at the time when that movie was out. Well, I'll tell you what, let's take one more call before we go into the break. And Uh-oh, this has got to be trouble. This is my buddy Chuck. Chuck, welcome to the show, man. How you doing?
Hey, Guy, I'm doing well. Hey, you were talking about the lawsuit, and my question is, the way they politicize an event like Sandy Hook, what are the chances that with the Supreme Court in the position that it's in currently, that the end game is possibly to take a case like this all the way to the Supreme Court?
Yeah, great question, Chuck. And I'll tell you, the way I would respond to that is this has got a fairly limited scope in terms of this particular lawsuit. It's really whether this statute protects a gun manufacturer on a jurisdictional level. And then who knows, once we get into the substance of litigating that issue of whether there's substantive defense to liability under that statute, then that might be worth something, worth, you know, taking up to the Supreme Court as a plaintiff and trying to get something done. Now, it's a little scary because depending on how the lower court rules, once it goes up to the Supreme Court, if it's 4-4, because Scalia's not there, however the lower court ruled is going to stick. In other words, it's the same as affirming the lower court decision. You need a majority of 5-4 or greater to overturn a lower court decision. So two thoughts. One, it's a fairly limited scope in terms of this lawsuit. I think that the gun control folks would want to take a case up where they have a positive lower court ruling that sticks if the Supreme Court doesn't get a majority on it, and that has broader application. In other words, something that would reconsider the Heller decision as to whether or not the Second Amendment even confers an individual right to bear arms at all. And or, you know, what limitations are still allowable even under the Heller decision that says, yeah, there's an individual right, but states can still enact reasonable limitations on the right to possess a gun. Well, what does reasonable mean? And would that include, for instance, an assault weapon ban, which is an issue that's also in the Connecticut courts right now? So I think something like, you know, can we still have an assault weapons ban broadly under the Heller decision, or can we reconsider Heller? I think those are the things that Supreme Court would likely be pushed to hear by those seeking more gun control. And with that, and thanks to Chuck for his call, good buddy of mine, been my best buddy for a long, long time. But with that, we're going to head into a break. If you're on hold, including Kathy, you've been holding for a while, have patience with us. We'll be right to you after the break, after we talk about this new ordinance. But stick around or join the discussion, 239-9393. You can contact me also on Twitter at Guy Relford or on the Gun Guy Facebook page, which is just Gun Guy WIBC on Facebook. So stick around. This is Guy Relford on the Gun Guy Show on 93 WIBC.
Now you've got a gun guy, Guy Relford, on 93 WIBC.
All right, welcome back. I'm Guy Relford, and this is the Gun Guy Show on 93 WIBC. And tonight we've been talking about this lawsuit where the victims of the Sandy Hook shooting are suing Bushmaster, the manufacturer of the AR-15 that was used by Adam Lanza to murder all those innocent people in Sandy Hook Elementary. And we've had a number of calls on that. And we're also expecting here at some point a call from Aaron Freeman, who's an Indianapolis city councilor who has a pending ordinance to keep Eagle Creek Pistol Range open to the public. And so we may cut away to talk to the councilor. But in the meantime, we're going to go back to the phone lines and we'll talk to Kathy. Kathy, welcome to the Gun Guy Show. Kathy, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yeah. What you got for us tonight?
Well, I wanted to ask you a question. I've been thinking about this for several days.
Uh-huh.
I was introduced to the shooting sports about 4 years ago, and I love shooting sporting clays.
Oh, awesome.
And a few days ago, and even before that, I've been somewhat interested in using a handgun. I have small hands and kind of weak hands, so I've experimented with several different weapons. But I've been very concerned about this little toddler that was 2 years old who supposedly shot himself several days ago. I mean, it's happening more and more, and I don't understand it. I wonder, from your perspective, how a little boy with a small hand and not the strength in his fingers can shoot something like that, because I sure can't.
Yeah, no, Kathy, thanks for your call, and it's a great question. And I got to tell you, I've mentioned this on the Gun Guy Show before in the context of other accidental shootings. And, man, I am so tired of reading these stories or seeing them on the news where little kids get access to guns. Why? Because they're not being stored responsibly. Now, this was a lady who sat her purse down on a counter, evidently, and the little kid climbed up and was digging around through her purse, found this handgun, and shot himself accidentally and died. And man, I mean, the first rule of gun ownership is always keep guns so they're inaccessible to untrained or unauthorized people. You know, and your two-year-old is not either trained or authorized to handle your guns by definition. Now, you know, we always hate to pile on someone who's lost a child. I mean, this person's clearly being punished beyond belief for that little slip of mind. And how many people come home and just set their purse up on a counter somewhere and not think about the fact that their kids may access that purse? But man, when the ramifications are as significant as they are, we have to think about that. And we have to act accordingly. Now, Kathy's actual question is, how can a two-year-old have the strength to pull a trigger on a gun? Is a great question. And Kathy, my answer to you is that guns have a dramatic range of trigger pulls in terms of the amount of pressure you have to pull on a trigger to make that gun fire. And for instance, there are precision rifles, and I've pulled these triggers. A great guy that used to work for me out at Eagle Creek Pistol Range, Mike Swindell. This guy's a sniper. He's a long range shooter. He does long range competitions, and he's got rifles that have brakes that have triggers that are under a half a pound in terms of the amount of pressure you need to put on those. And some double action only revolvers and double action only semi-automatics have 8 to 10 pound trigger pulls. So there's a dramatic range in terms of how much pressure you have to put on that trigger and how much trigger travel, the actual distance the trigger has to move before the gun goes off. Dramatic difference. The general thought is that a self-defense gun, particularly a gun without an external safety, a safety that you have to disengage for that gun to shoot, typically shouldn't be under somewhere in the 4 to 4.5 pound range in terms of how much pressure you have to put on that gun, because you get to less pressure than that, lighter triggers than that, then that can create a safety issue. So this gun, you know, how did a two-year-old pull a trigger? Well, I don't know what kind of gun it was, but there are guns, for instance, that don't have external safeties that have what I would call sort of a mid-range or medium trigger in them. Just by way of example, a Glock, and I own 4 Glocks. Glocks are great for what they are: ultra reliable, reasonably accurate. And that's why they're carried by something like 65% of police departments across the country. But there's no external safety, and they come from the factory with a 5.5 pound trigger. Now, can a two-year-old, and keep in mind, it may have been using two hands. Now, I don't know. I have no idea. But just speculating, may have had two fingers inside the trigger guard. And can a two-year-old generate 5.5 pounds of pressure, perhaps with two hands? Yeah, maybe. Or maybe if the gun was just thrown into the purse, there might have been something else in the purse inside the trigger guard. One of the reasons that we teach in our classes at Tactical Firearms Training that ladies should never just throw a gun in their purse with all their other stuff just floating around in there with their checkbook and their keys and their sunglasses and makeup and any number of other things, is how many things inside a lady's purse can get inside the trigger guard. You know, lipstick or eyeliner, keys, or the Templon sunglasses, who knows what. There could have been something in already putting pressure on the trigger, and by just messing around with the contents of the purse could have caused enough pressure to be exerted on that trigger for the gun to go off. But I think it's a legitimate question that Kathy asks, because a two-year-old, you wouldn't think, would be able to generate a lot of pressure on that trigger. But if it's a lighter trigger, if it's in that 5 range, 5.5 that a lot of guns come from the manufacturer with, then we can see that happening and resulting in a tragedy like this. But the way to the way to prevent that from happening is not say, well, I got to have one of these double action only semi-automatics like a Smith Bodyguard or a Ruger LC9. There's a gazillion of them out there. The Shield, the Smith Shield. There are a lot of semi-auto pistols that are double action only that have really long, heavy trigger pulls. And they're long and heavy in part as a safety factor. But the way to prevent a tragedy like this is not to buy a gun with a heavy trigger, is to make sure your guns are locked up. And that kids and any other unauthorized or untrained person doesn't have access to your guns. That's how we prevent these tragedies. And I teach it and I preach it and I preach it on the radio. But man, every time we have a tragedy like this, they're always 100% preventable. 100% preventable. And I'm not trying to jump on a poor lady that's now lost her son, but it's a lesson that we have to learn, and one that she obviously learned the hard way. In the hardest of possible ways. All right, we're going to take a break. If you're on the phone, stick around. We're going to get to you right after this break, but we're going to be back. Join the discussion, 239-9393, or on Twitter at Guy Relford. And I've actually got one question I'm going to address here in just a bit on the Gun Guy Facebook page, which is Gun Guy WIBC. So join the discussion. We'll be right back. This is Guy Relford on the Gun Guy Show on 93 WIBC.
Second to none on the Second Amendment. This is the Gun Guy with Guy Relford on 93 WIBC.
And welcome back. This is Guy Relford on the Gun Guy Show on 93 WIBC. Been talking about a number of things tonight. Including the lawsuit against Bushmaster over the Sandy Hook shooting, but also anything you want to talk about here on the Gun Guy Show. And with that, we're going to go right back to the phone lines, and we've got Brent. Brent, welcome to the Gun Guy Show.
Thanks for taking my call.
Sure.
I've actually called before back in December, but my question for you tonight was I was listening a few weeks ago, and I remember somebody calling in and asking about getting gun rights restored, and I wanted to know if you had any information on how to maybe go about getting something like that started.
Yeah, there are a couple different ways, Brent, and I won't ask you any personal information over the radio. It kind of depends on what the conviction was or what the legal issue was that caused gun rights to be lost in the first place. But for instance, if it's a felony conviction, if you have any felony under federal law, you can't possess a firearm. Doesn't matter if it was a lowest level felony from 30 years ago, it still precludes you from possessing a gun. Some misdemeanors, including any crime of domestic violence, will also make you lose your ability to possess a firearm. So it kind of depends. If you're currently under a restraining order, what we call an order of protection. If you're currently under an order of protection and the person being protected by that order falls within certain classes of people like a spouse or ex-girlfriend or someone you had a child with, something along those lines, then you're also precluded from possessing a firearm. In that situation, the order of protection just needs to expire. They're typically 2 years. But if you're if the reason you've lost your gun rights is because of a criminal conviction, if it's a low-level felony or if it's a misdemeanor, we can have those expunged. And expungement in Indiana has been made easier. There was a new expungement statute that just went into effect a couple of years ago. It makes it easier. A lot of people are calling that the Second Chance Law. And there's been an important change in the law of expungement because until November of last year, the feds, through the Department of Justice and ATF, had taken the position that Indiana's expungement statute wasn't effective to restore your gun rights. Because our expungement statute doesn't completely remove your conviction from your record when it's a felony. All it does is it seals your record. And anyone other than law enforcement, if they do a background check on you, won't see it. So if you go in for a job interview or any other type circumstance other than law enforcement, looking at your criminal record, if that new employer that you're seeking a job at runs a background check on you, they would not see your conviction if it's been expunged, but law enforcement can see it. And if you get in trouble again, that conviction comes back. So because our statute doesn't result in a felony being completely wiped off your record, the feds, until November of last year, had taken the position that it did not restore your gun rights. They've changed that. And they sent a letter out, and I've got a copy of it. including sending it to the Indiana State Police, who handle our applications for licenses to carry handgun. And in that situation, the feds are now saying if the order of expungement, and if your lawyer puts the right language in the proposed order that you submit to the judge as part of those expungement proceedings, if that expungement order has the right language in it, what we call restorative language, and that is their language that specifically says that your civil rights are restored, including your right to possess a handgun or possess a firearm generally, under both state and federal law, if your order of expungement has the right language in it, this restorative language, and it's very specific, if that order of expungement has that language in it, then it does restore your rights. So that will result in you being able to possess a gun under federal law. It will also result in you being able to get a license to carry a handgun in Indiana, which you currently cannot if you have any kind of felony. And until the feds change their position on that, the Indiana State Police were not issuing licenses to carry to people with expunged felonies because they have a regulation that says they won't issue a license to anyone who can't possess a gun under federal law. So the feds needed to take their position for us to fix that under Indiana law as well. So that process has changed. So I hope that answers your question, Brent. And now we're going to go into a break here in just a bit. We're going to continue to talk about a number of issues. Also, join the discussion, 239-9393, or contact me on Twitter at Guy Relford. This is Guy Relford on The Gun Guy Show on 93 WIBC.
A well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state. The right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. This is the Second Amendment, and this is The Gun Guy.
Boom, 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 boom. Bang, 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 bang. Boom, 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 boom. Bang, bang, bang.
With Guy Relford on 93 WIBC.
And welcome back. This is Guy Relford on The Gun Guy Show on 93 WIBC. And we're talking about a number of things, including this lawsuit brought by the victims of Sandy Hook and the heirs, the relatives of those that perished in that horrific shooting, as well as some of the surviving folks who were wounded. And the fact that a judge has refused to dismiss that lawsuit, but at a very early stage. And I opened the show by talking about how we shouldn't get too antagonistic toward that judge at this point, because the reason that she refused to throw the lawsuit out was purely on the basis of she decided that she could hear the case. That was really all that was decided. She could decide the legal issues in the case. And if, after ruling on all the other motions that are likely to come in this case to have it dismissed, if the case survives all those additional motions, then it can perhaps go to a jury. But some of the reporting on that issue has seemed to indicate that because she set a trial date, which she naturally is going to do as part of any scheduling order in any lawsuit, the judge sets trial dates. That doesn't mean that the case goes to trial. And that's how that's been reported, that because there was a trial date, that everyone was assuming that the lawsuit was going to go to the jury at some point. And you know what? In somewhere around 100% of cases, a trial date gets set. And in civil cases, do you know how many of those cases actually go to trial? Depending on what part of the country you're in and whether you're in state and federal court, that's somewhere between 3% and 5%. So the fact that there's a trial date scheduled, we shouldn't get too up in arms about, because a lot of legal maneuvering, including bringing up a lot of defenses, including the statutory defense under this Protection of Lawful Commerce in Arms Act, that is a federal statute that provides immunity to gun manufacturers who legally sell their guns. When someone then takes that legally sold or legally manufactured gun and commits a criminal act with it. So that's what we opened the show with. But in the meantime, I've gotten a question on the Gun Guy Facebook page that I wanted to address. Somebody wrote me a message and said that they need a gunsmith, and we're looking for a recommendation from me. And I'll tell you what, I have used a couple of gunsmiths in the central Indiana area that have done great by me. My friend Nick Latham at Nalco Gunsmithing, he's actually over right off 32 approaching Lebanon. But Nalco, N-A-L-C-O, Nick has done great work for me, including, by the way, milling the slide on an Ed Brown Special Forces carry in order to mount an RMR red dot. on that thing. And I'll tell you, when you start, we start talking about milling the slide of an Ed Brown, which is not an inexpensive firearm, I was not going to trust that to just anybody. And Nick did a fabulous job, and was really pleased with the result. And Alan Moore of Moore Gunworks, he's actually in Avon. And Alan does a fabulous job as well. He does some detailed gunsmithing. He does a lot of refinishing. But I would absolutely trust Alan Moore of Moore Gunworks as well. Those are not, you know, paid endorsements by any means. I'm just responding to a question. But those are just two folks around that that I've had great experience with. And by the way, if you've had a gunsmith around central Indiana or within the listening range here for the Gun Guy show, I'd love to hear about it. You know, send me a message on Facebook at Gun Guy WIBC or send me a message on Twitter because you know what? There aren't enough good gunsmiths around. There just aren't. And they're hard to find, as indicated by the fact that I've driven to Lebanon or driven to Avon, and I live in Zionsville. In order to take my guns to a gunsmith that I had confidence in. That doesn't mean there aren't a hell of a lot more. It just means I don't know about them. And I've been a gun owner in this area for a long, long time. I think we need more. And those that are out there, we'd sure like to know about them. So we hope you out there, if you know of additional qualified gunsmith, I hope you let us know. All right, we're going to shift topics here a little bit. As I forecast at the start of the show, there has been an ordinance. We had Jack Sandlin, who's one of the city councilors who introduced this ordinance in the Indianapolis City Council. He was on last week to give us a little bit of a description of what it is. What it is, as many of you know from listening to the Gun Guy show or from other media, the city has closed Eagle Creek Pistol Range. And my company, Tactical Firearms Training, we actually managed the range. We operated the range on weekends for the last 5 years. And that's where Tactical Firearms Training has been teaching its classes for the last 5 years. And while we're extremely excited about our new collaboration with Indy Arms and the classes we're teaching out there, we're also disappointed that the public range at Eagle Creek is no longer available to the public. Why? Because the public pays for it. This is a public range. It's a public range also that got federal grant money from the National Parks Department on the specific condition that it remain open to the public. If you take federal grant money for a public park, it has to remain a public park. And the law requires that. So the city of Indianapolis right now is violating federal law by closing that range and not allowing it to be accessed by the public. And frankly, I think it's letting down the taxpayers of Marion County who pay for the range. So, yeah, taxpayers, we want you to pay for it, but you can't use it. And I personally think that stinks. Now, I'm not any longer interested in managing the range out there after the way the city went about closing the range. If they called me tomorrow and said, hey, we changed our mind, we're going to reopen Eagle Creek, I would very much hope they'd find someone to operate it, someone qualified, someone who's certified as a chief range safety officer, as I am, and who's someone who's only going to employ trained, certified range safety officers, as we did, to supervise the range. I would hope the city would be able to find somebody like that. But I would very politely tell them to show affection to my posterior in a way that I'm sure you can imagine what I'm saying, because I don't like the way they went about closing the range. It was out of the blue. It was without any notice. And I think it was a great disservice, not only to the folks that work for me out there, but also the taxpayers in Marion County. So I'm no fan of the people who made that decision, whether it was in the Parks Department or the mayor's office or wherever that occurred. I think it was a wrong decision, but they've lost me in terms of who there may ever get to reopen the range to the public. But on that note, the ordinance that's pending right now would require the range to reopen to the public when it's not being used for training purposes by the Indianapolis Metropolitan Police Department. They currently use the range 7 days a week. When we still operated the range and it was open to the public, they trained out there just 5 days a week during the week, and then we operated the range on weekends. Well, this ordinance has been introduced, and if you go to indy.gov, you can find your city councilor if you want to express an opinion on this, and please make that known to your city councilor if you live in Marion County. But it was assigned to a committee, and that committee had a hearing on that on it this week, which was Wednesday night, and it didn't get very far. They actually voted to postpone considering it in the committee. Now, the committee can either recommend that it pass, or they can recommend that it not pass, but then it goes to the full city council. And this particular committee is 6 Democrats and 4 Republicans, so that probably doesn't bode well for how they're going to ultimately vote. But I testified just about how I thought this was a disservice to Marion County taxpayers, and also about the issue of the acceptance of federal grants that actually requires the range to be open to the public. And a number of the councilors considered it, but they ultimately decided to postpone voting on it because they wanted to hear specifically from the police chief, Chief Riggs. And they also wanted to hear from somebody from the Parks Department. And Parks Department, at least ostensibly, made the decision to close it. So they wanted to hear from somebody from the Parks Department, because Parks Department actually manages the property. And they're the ones ostensibly, and whether that was at the direction of Mayor Hogsett or whatnot, we don't know. I certainly don't know. But they're the ones that at least communicated that decision to me. So that's where it's at. It's been postponed. They'll reschedule a committee hearing for next month, and the committee will then vote, and then it'll go to the full city council to be voted on there. But if you have an opinion on that, go to indy.gov, click on city council, find your counselor, and give them a call. And tell them how you want them ultimately to vote on this ordinance. Do you think a public range paid for by the public should be accessible by the public? I think that's a fairly easy question to answer, but we'll see how the city council addresses this issue. All right, we're at the quarter hour. We're going to take a break. We got a couple people on hold that want to discuss any number of gun-related issues, so feel free to join that discussion at 239-9393. That's 239-9393. Contact me on Twitter at Guy Relford, or contact me on the Gun Guy Facebook page, which was Gun Guy WIBC. We'll be right back. This is Guy Relford on the Gun Guy Show on 93 WIBC.
The sky is crying.
Your rights, your responsibilities, your guns. This is The Gun Guy with Guy Relford on 93 WIBC.
All right, welcome back. I'm Guy Relford, and this is The Gun Guy Show on 93 WIBC. And we just had an update. I just went through this pending ordinance that would require the city to keep Eagle Creek Pistol Range open to the public when it's not being used for training by IMPD. And I believe Larry on the phones wants to talk about that. So, Larry, welcome to the Gun Guy Show.
How you doing, guy?
Doing good, buddy. Thanks for calling. What you got?
Yeah, I seen a picture of you. You look like a pretty fair guy. and fellow, anyway. But anyway, that's going to – I think it came out of committee a couple of nights ago in a committee. So I think that Sandlin and a couple other Republicans are going to have that open again. And like you said, it's a stupid idea to close it because our tax dollars pays for it. So they're going to come in. I got another question for you.
Yeah, yeah. And by the way, Larry, just one point. I was at that committee hearing. In fact, I testified at that hearing, and they actually postponed voting on it. So it's now, okay, I think, going to be voted on in the May meeting of that committee.
That's what I didn't see you down there.
Yeah, no, I think they're gonna ultimately add it. But Alex, you said you had another point. What else you got for us?
Hey, now what if I got some red? This red-tailed hawk is zooming in on my chickens. What remedy do I have against them?
Well, if I don't know off the top of my head that red-tailed hawks have any particular protection. I don't think they're an endangered species or anything like that. If they're considered a nuisance animal, like a coyote, for instance, you can protect yourself and protect your livestock from them by shooting them or otherwise, you know, doing what you need to do to get rid of that nuisance. Again, I don't know if there's any particular protections that apply to the red-tailed hawk. It'd be an easy thing to look up and find in a couple of minutes. But the only thing you got to worry about is, and if you've got chickens, I assume you're out in the country to some degree. The only thing you got to worry about, you got to worry about discharging a firearm within city limits, and you got to worry about some people who have fired guns, for instance, at dogs that were acting like they were going to attack them or something along those lines. People have been charged for criminal recklessness if they've discharged a gun in an area where there are other people. And that gunshot endangered those other people. So I don't know if you're out in a country sufficient to not endanger anybody else by taking a shot. You're not in city limits. Then that becomes less of an issue. And assuming there's no particular protection for a red-tailed hawk, then you can protect your livestock is my answer for you, Larry. Is that get it for you?
Thanks, guy.
All right, man. All right. Well, that's... That's it from Larry. If you want to join the discussion with any additional questions, feel free to call in 239-9393, 239-9393. We'd be glad to take your questions here on the air. Discussing the lawsuit against Remington, we actually have a very similar situation playing out right here in Indiana. If you're not familiar with this, it received some publicity when it was first filed, and it recently went up to the Court of Appeals, and... the Court of Appeals has allowed this for now, the case to continue, but it's still a question of whether this case will now go to the Indiana Supreme Court. And I'm sure the defendant is pursuing what we call transfer to the Supreme Court to also consider this case. But this case is called Runnels versus KSNE Sports, and it raises almost the identical issue that we were just discussing in this Bushmaster case, where the victims or the families of the victims of the Sandy Hook shooting are suing the manufacturer of the AR-15 that was used by Adam Lanza in that shooting. Very similar situation, and that's happening right here in Indiana, is a police officer, Dwayne Runnels. And Dwayne goes by a nickname which is currently escaping me. I want to say Rusty, please, my forgiveness, Officer Runnels. But name is Dwayne Runnels, and he was shot after stopping a car on suspicion that the occupants had been involved in a series of burglaries, I believe, or robberies. But he stopped the car, and a bad guy by the name of Martin got out of the car and shot Officer Runnels and shot him in the hip, and the round ricocheted up, I believe, into his torso and caused some significant injuries, but he survived. Thankfully, he survived. But Officer Runnels now has filed a lawsuit against the retailer, not the manufacturer like they did in the Sandy Hook case, but against the retailer, KSNE Sports, which is over on Pendleton Pike, I believe. And The facts of this case are interesting in that the bad guy, Martin, went into KSNE with another gentleman named Blackburn, and they went in there together, and they looked at a number of different handguns, and allegedly, this is what the lawsuit says. We'll see whether this is proven in court if the lawsuit ultimately goes to trial. But what at least the allegation is that Martin, who was the bad guy, Martin could not buy a gun on his own because he was a convicted felon. And convicted felons, doesn't matter what the felony is, doesn't matter how long ago it is, if you have a felony conviction on your record that hasn't been expunged, and we talked about expungement a little earlier, but if you have a felony on your record, you can't buy a gun. You don't pass the background check. Well, allegedly, Martin, the guy with a felony conviction, picked out a particular gun and showed Blackburn the gun he wanted, and then they both left. And a little while later, Blackburn went back into the store. Again, this is just the allegations in the complaint, so don't take all of this as necessarily being absolute fact, because we'll see whether all this is proven or not. But at least according to the allegations of the complaint in the lawsuit, Blackburn came back in later and bought the gun. Because, by the way, Blackburn did not have a criminal record such that he could buy a gun. He bought the gun that Martin had selected, allegedly, went out in the parking lot, and gave it to Martin, the convicted felon. And Martin then paid him the same amount that Blackburn had paid KSNE, the gun store. Thereafter, a couple months go by, and Officer Reynolds pulls the car over. Martin gets out of it, shoots the officer. Well, Officer Reynolds now is suing KSNE, saying KSNE should not have sold the gun. And that as a result of KSNE selling the gun, they should be liable for the injuries, the very significant injuries suffered by Officer Reynolds. And again, this one I have mixed emotions about, because if you listen to the Gun Guy Show, you know we're very pro-law enforcement here, that I'm a big supporter of our local police department, IMPD, and various police departments around central Indiana. I think do a fabulous job and put their lives on the line to protect the rest of us every day. And so Officer Reynolds doing his job and really a hero to have done what he did, because he, my understanding, if my recollection is correct, he shot Martin and killed him. And so there's one less bad guy out there. And again, thankfully, Officer Reynolds survived, but he filed this lawsuit. And the allegation again is that KSNE shouldn't have sold the gun. They should have known enough about the transaction, especially with Martin picking out the gun he wanted, and then the other guy coming back and buying that gun, that they shouldn't have bought the gun. Well, we have a very similar statute to the Protection of Lawful Commerce in Arms Act, which is a federal act. We've got a very similar act right here in Indiana. And what our statute says is that, and there are some exceptions in terms of the kinds of lawsuits that you can file, but other than, including, by the way, you can sue a gun manufacturer or a gun seller if they sell you a defective gun. And you can sue a gun seller for breach of contract. If you pay for the gun, they don't give it to you, you can sue them. But outside a certain limited number of exceptions, what our statute says is that you may not bring or maintain an action against a firearms or ammunition manufacturer or seller for the recovery of damage resulting from the lawful sale of that gun. That includes other things like lawful design, lawful manufacture, because it also protects manufacturers. But as to this lawsuit, it says you can't maintain an action based on the lawful sale of a gun. And it also says you can't maintain an action, bring an action or maintain an action for the recovery of damages resulting from the criminal or unlawful misuse of a firearm by a third party. Well, here you had a convicted felon, Martin, who unlawfully shot Officer Reynolds. So when I saw this lawsuit initially, and I was asked by the Indy Star to take a look at this and tell them what I thought, I said, well, this is clearly an action based on the lawful sale of a gun, unless KSNE knew this was a straw purchase. And if they knew it was a straw purchase, then it's not the lawful sale of a gun. It'd be an unlawful sale of a gun if you know the gun is a straw purchase and you sell the gun anyway. But it also, though, clearly is the recovery of damages, the attempted recovery of damages through this lawsuit resulting from the criminal misuse of a firearm by a third party, meaning Martin, the bad guy who shot Officer Reynolds. So how is this not within the lawsuit? Well, the defendant, KSNE, brought what's called a motion for judgment on the pleadings. Basically, it's just saying, judge, read what they're alleging. Just based on what they're saying, they can't proceed with their lawsuit. And ultimately, the Indiana Court of Appeals decided that they could. And I'm going to tell you why when we come back from the break, because it's interesting, because the statute seems very clear cut. And the reason I think there's a very high likelihood that the Supreme Court may want to take a look at this is I think the Court of Appeals decision and their logic behind it is subject to some criticism and maybe just the kind of case the Supreme Court of Indiana wants to take a look at. But we'll go into details on that. We'll also take your calls. We got a number of people on hold. When we come back, join the discussion, 239-9393. Contact me on Twitter at Guy Relford. Contact me on the Gun Guy Facebook page, which is Gun Guy WIBC. We'll be right back. This is Guy Relford on the Gun Guy Show on 93 WIBC.
The show about gun rights, gun safety, and responsible gun ownership. This is The Gun Guy with Guy Relford on 93 WIBC.
All right, welcome back. I'm Guy Relford. This is The Gun Guy Show. And I'll tell you what, we're going to go right back to the phone lines. We've got a number of people who are on hold, and we're going to go right to Walt. Walt, welcome to the I can talk. Welcome to The Gun Guy Show.
Hey, guys. Really enjoy the show.
Thank you.
Hey, I don't get to listen to you all the time, but got a question. I used to live in Ohio, and I had my Ohio concealed carry, and the Ohio concealed carry covered Indiana. I moved to Indiana and got my Indiana concealed carry. And due to some personal things happen, I forgot to renew my Ohio license. And I was wanting to know, what do I have to do to renew that? Can I just pay the back fee for it, or do I have to go take their 16-hour test again, or course again?
Well, unfortunately, Walt, I'm not an Ohio lawyer, and I really don't know their process over there. So I apologize. I can't answer your question. I can tell you it's a good thing that when you move to Indiana that you got your Indiana license to carry, because while Indiana recognizes every other state's license or permit for carrying a handgun or concealed carry of a handgun, that's only for non-Indiana residents. So it's good that you got yours from here. But in terms of what the process is in Ohio, buddy, I have no idea. I've never been through it and never talked to anybody who has, and I'm not an Ohio lawyer, so I really can't answer that question for you.
Okay, I'll go. I've got to get online and check it out.
Yep. Sorry about that. Yep. I should change the name of my show to the Indiana Gun Guy. All right. Back to the phone lines, and we've got Jim. Jim, welcome to the Gun Guy Show.
Hey, how's it going?
Good, my friend.
This is about the guy that called about the red tail hawk and his chickens.
Yeah, huh?
Any bird of prey is a protected bird.
Is it?
Yep. Hawk, owls, falcons, eagles.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Well, I absolutely knew eagles and yeah. Well, go ahead, Jim.
Any bird of prey is a protected bird. So
All right.
Pass that one along.
There you go. And that, you know, and as you recall, I said that I didn't know what protections there were on a red-tailed hawk. But now that you say that, Jim, that makes perfect sense that birds of prey are protected, and that does make a lot of sense. So I guess you need to focus your efforts more on just protecting the chickens in terms of trying to keep them protected with enclosures or fencing or whatever it might be than taking vengeance on the hawk. So, Jim, thanks so much for calling in. You set us straight on that. And like I said, I didn't know what protections there were or were not on red-tailed hawks, so that helped us a lot, and you may have kept our previous caller out of trouble, so we appreciate that a lot. All right, back to the phone lines. We got Charlie. Charlie, welcome to the Gun Guy Show.
Yeah, guy, good show. Always like to listen to you.
Good, sir. I appreciate that.
I don't know if you've heard about it, but a new law went just through that's going to allow rifles for private property for deer hunting.
Yeah, exactly. Uh-huh. I did. And they list the specific calibers of what you can use. I'm not a big hunter. I do a lot of shooting, but all my shooting is really focused on personal protection, self-defense. That's why I call my company Tactical Firearms Training, because that's what we're focused on. But I did read that statute, and I couldn't list the calibers for you, but we are certainly allowing. I know 30 calibers included. I think .223 is included and a number of others, but I don't know off the top of my head what all those calibers are.
Well, the only reason I'm calling in is just to get your opinion about it. They allow us a .243.
Yeah, I saw that.
Or 6mm.
Uh-huh.
And then they make the big jump to 30 caliber.
Yep, I saw that too.
And but in that 30 caliber could be a 300 Win mag. Or it could be a 300 Weatherby mag. But they won't let us use a .270. A .260, a .280, and I guess the only reason I'm calling is just to get your opinion about it. How silly can our legislators be by making a big jump like that? Why couldn't they just set .243 to 300? Could be done with it.
Yeah, and you know, the way a lot of gun ranges deal with that situation, say a gun range has a rifle range and they want to limit the caliber so they don't have to worry about having their baffles or their bullet capture system, whatever it might be, damaged in some way, they'll just say something like everything below a certain caliber. Like they'll say 308 and under, and just list it that way, or 300 Win Mag and smaller, or anything below 50 BMG. You hear that all the time. Anything below 50 caliber you can shoot. So, you know, it seemed to me that might have been a better way to go because there's so many calibers out there, Charlie. And because I agree with your point, is it defies logic a little bit to say, wait a minute, you're going to allow larger calibers than I have, or calibers, I guess the more important way of putting it is calibers with more energy in terms of bullet mass and muzzle velocity. They're going to travel farther, they're going to maintain more energy for longer distances, and therefore potentially do more damage down range to whatever they might hit, that you're going to allow, you know, higher calibers, higher velocity or higher energy calibers than my rifle, but you don't allow my rifle. And I do think if they maintain this on the books, I think they're doing it now. I'll guarantee you, I think they're going to want to take a look at it. At least I've heard, just in terms of, are we going to see additional accidental shootings? I don't believe that's going to happen, by the way. But one thing they may want to look at down the road is just coming up with maybe a little more logical system of identifying acceptable calibers, of just identify a maximum and then allow everything underneath that. And maybe that's too difficult. Maybe, you know, in terms of the number and classification of ammunition and of rounds there are out there, that they thought that was just too complicated or people wouldn't understand. And if they list particular calibers, that'd be easier to follow. I can get that, but it seems to me like, to me, and I agree with Charlie's point, they probably should have come up with a longer list based on the logic that Charlie mentioned, which I agree with. All right, back to the phone lines. We've got Barry. Barry, welcome to the Gun Guy Show.
Thank you very much for taking my call. I got two quick questions, I hope. My wife and I are going to be traveling the United States with a camper, and I was just wondering, I do have a lifetime carry permit here in the state of Indiana, but is there something else that I need to purchase or take some type of a training so I can carry my gun throughout the United States?
Yeah, and this is a handgun, Barry?
Yes, this is a small caliber handgun.
Yeah, well, a couple of things you need to know. And do you have a license to carry here in Indiana?
Yes, I have a lifetime license.
Okay, I think you mentioned that. All right, well, yeah, Barry, a couple of things you need to know. One is where your Indiana license to carry handgun is recognized and where it's not. And Indiana's up to, I believe the number is 30, since Ohio started recognizing our license last spring. I think the number is up to 30 in terms of the states that recognize our license. It was 29 before Ohio. And a good way to find that out is either there's an app you can download to your cell phone just called CCW. And it's got a gun kind of superimposed over a United States flag. That's the emblem that you want to look for. It's just called CCW, and you can download that to your phone. You put in what your home state is. You identify whether you have a license in your home state. And then you can get a summary of other states' laws. You can also go to the reciprocity information on that app, and it'll show you every state where your license to carry handgun is recognized. So that's step one. And like when I go on a motorcycle trip, one thing I do, I actually go to on a desktop app. The best one I've found is the one on the U.S. Concealed Carry Association's page. And they have both usconcealedcarry.com and .net. And they have different information on each of those. But if you find their reciprocity page at U.S. Concealed Carry Association, then it's pretty easy to put in your home state. It asks you whether you have a license in your home state, yes or no. Do you have any non-resident licenses? So if you have a Utah non-resident license or a Florida or Arizona, the several states that issue non-resident, you say yes or no. And then, boom, a map comes up that shows you every state where you're legal. And that's pretty easy to follow. The other thing you need to know is about the Firearm Owners Protection Act of 1986. And that tells you that you can carry a gun in a vehicle if you're legal where your point of origin is and you're legal where your destination is. You can carry the gun through any other state or local jurisdiction, notwithstanding their laws to the contrary, so long as the gun is stored in a particular way, and that's unloaded and stored in a locked container separate from any ammunition, inaccessible from you, and that has to be a locked compartment other than the glove compartment or the console. And if you don't have a separate compartment from your passenger compartment, in other words, if you don't have a trunk, then it has to be in a locked container as far away from you as you can get it. So, and that's not the exact wording of the statute. I would say Google Firearm Owners Protection Act of 1986, and it'll pop right up, and you'll see the exact wording with those requirements. But that's a way for you to have a gun as you're traveling legally, and even in those states that don't recognize your Indiana license to carry handgun. Sorry, we're going to take a break. We're a little late going into this break, but we're going to take a break. Call us back with your questions. We always love taking questions from the callers. This is Guy Relford on The Gun Guy Show on 93 WIBC.
Your rights, your responsibilities, your guns. This is The Gun Guy with Guy Relford on 93 WIBC.
And welcome back. I'm Guy Relford on The Gun Guy Show on 93 WIBC. And just had a question on The Gun Guy Facebook page in a private message. It says, Guy, I understand the law on trusts is changing. Can you explain? And that's from David. David, I'm sure you're talking about NFA, National Firearms Act trusts, or sometimes we just call them gun trusts. And yeah, the law is changing. And I believe the effective date is July 13th. But this is actually part of the executive orders that Obama signed at the beginning of the year on gun control. And there had been something out there. We called it 41P. Now it's 41F. The P was for pending, and now it's for final. But this was a proposed rule in how the ATF is going to process applications to acquire NFA-regulated items. And we talk about National Firearms Act-regulated items. We're talking about fully automatic firearms, what are called machine guns in the Act, suppressors, short-barreled rifles, short-barreled shotguns, and a couple of other categories we call any other weapon or destructive devices. But the for years, you could purchase or apply to acquire one of those items under the NFA. These are items that require a tax stamp. You have to get specific permission to acquire those. You have to get that permission from the ATF. For years, you could apply either as an individual, or you could apply as a company, or you can apply in the name of a trust. And a trust is just a legal entity that can own stuff. And a gun trust is specifically authorized by law to possess a NFA regulated item, like a suppressor or a machine gun or a short-barreled rifle. And so for years people have done that in the name of a trust, and they went through faster because for a trust there was no background check and there was no requirement to submit fingerprints. Where the big changes that are now going to go into effect relate to those things, and that is under 41P, which goes into effect in July. Now, when you submit an application to build an NFA item, like you want to build a short-barreled rifle, or you want to transfer an NFA item like a suppressor, and you're going to do that in the name of the trust, all quote-unquote responsible persons under that trust, that's going to be the person who created the trust, what we call a settlor, any co-trustees or beneficiaries named in that trust all have to submit fingerprint cards. They'll all go through a background check as part of the ATF process to ultimately approve your application. It's a Form 1 to build an NFA item. It's a Form 4 to transfer an NFA item. And so a lot of people are creating trusts now, and they're not trying to – these are not criminals who have criminal backgrounds trying to get – NFA items, they just know it's going to take longer to get an NFA item in the name of a trust after these changes go into effect. So a lot of people are getting trusts. We do trusts at my law office, and we're doing a lot of them right now because people want to get those in. Because if they're in the queue, if you've submitted your application before the changes go into effect, then it's going to be, we believe, quite a bit quicker to get those accepted. Well, we've come to the end of the Gun Guy Show. We thank you for all our questions. We had a number of great callers. Please join us next week. This is Guy Relford on the Gun Guy Show on 93 WIBC.